Okay.
All right, you're in the city of Columbus. Now, first off, you know she's coming to town August 12th. She's going to be at the Phoenix City Amphitheater along with Raheem Devine, Kenny Lattimore, and Sherelle. Tell us a little bit about how this show got put together.
Well, you know, we are in such restraints when it comes to great music.
Yes.
And for some reason or another, great music is getting away from us, which means we get very short-sighted concerts. And when we all, you know, when they asked me to be a part of the show, we all came together saying, well, what is it that people love and want that is affordable? It makes sense. Mm-hmm. I've just seen Kenny Lattimore, who is awesome live. He really is. Raheem is a very good friend of mine. He's awesome. And who just been added is Calvin Richardson.
Oh, okay. Oh, okay. Oh, okay. We playing it, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, I didn't even know you gave me an exclusive. There you go, so, Columbus. Right.
Calvin is the soul prince of the South.
Wow. Yeah.
And Sherelle is a good friend of mine. And, you know, a lot of great artists aren't getting work because radios are just not embracing great music the way they used to.
Mm-hmm.
So we figured, when I was growing up, we had a concert called Strawberry Letter 23. And it was Brothers Johnson, the Commodores, Earth, Wind & Fire, Rick James. All these people were on one stage, one night. And the place was sold out. So it made sense to me that everybody had to come together and agree to agree and say, hey, it's not about who's the hottest, who's the biggest star, who sold the most records. It's about an embodiment of great music.
Right.
So the collaboration of great artists is going to only give you great music.
That's right.
So when you come, you're going to get a little bit of this, you're going to get a little bit of that. And of course, it just was a no-brainer. If we could have five more artists added to that roster, we would make it happen. But because it's a venue that we've never played before, but we're trying to bring some validity to so that people know that you don't have to just play the Fox Theater in Atlanta. You shouldn't have to drive that far
to get a good show, right?
That's
right.
So we kind of put our heads together and I said, hey, let's just make it happen. So it's one of the reasons why I came down, because unless we, and I'm just not talking about the artists, but we as a culture, unless we don't come together as a unit, as one, and say, we can have backyard parties and picnics, and it ain't costing us $1 million to do it, we're going to lose our foundation, which is great music. We're going to lose it. So it's called sacrifice. And it's what we are all doing to make this show happen for the people of
Columbus. Thank you.
Well, we truly appreciate it. It all goes down August 12th at the Phoenix City Amphitheater. Miss Angie Stone, Sherelle, just added, we just learned, Calvin Richardson, also Raheem Devine and Kenny Lattimore. Now, when you speak about collaborations and things like that, who would be your, because you've been in the business a while. You've been doing your thing
Lauren
for a minute.
Hill.
Yeah.
Lauren.
Your ultimate collaboration would be Lauren Hill?
Wow.
Okay, so what would it be, up-tempo, a ballad? What would you want to do?
I think it would be a socially conscious record because, you know, I was with Wyclef about 2 weeks, 3 weeks ago. And she and I have never had this face-to-face kind of energy yet. But I said to Wyclef, I said, you know, she reminds me of me when I was in hip-hop, you know, days. And back then we did Funk You Up.
Somebody requested that today.
And we did that, and it was introducing singing to rap music. Mm-hmm. So when Lauryn Hill came around and did it, that generation thought it was brand new, but it wasn't brand new to me.
Right.
It was something that I was a part of. And when I said that, she is me and I am her, he said, and she knows and feels the same way you feel. That meant so much to me because it means that Lauren Hill and I are on the same page. And I've been wanting to connect with her, not for any fame or fortune, but just because socially conscious, strong black women. There's not that many. And I think when I did Brother, and I go down for my, I ride hard for my folks. And I think when we went, when I took that stance to go in that direction, I took a hit. And when I took a hit for the kingdom, because they don't like it when you tell the truth.
That's right.
So they come for your head. They don't book no shows. They don't play your music. They don't support you. They don't do any of that. And it's okay. Because at the end of the day, the music still wins.
That's right.
At the end
of the day, better let them know.
So when you do socially conscious music like that, and you think about other artists that do it, why do you feel that a lot of artists choose not to? It's because they fear the backlash?
Because a lot of people want fame. They want fame and they want fortune. They don't want to. See, I operate in the gift that God gave me. It doesn't belong to me.
Yes.
It belongs to the people. And when we trade out our purpose for the dollar, then we miss the whole mark. You can have what we call temporary fame and fortune here, but when you cross over, you got to answer that.
Come on, Angie.
So for me, of course, I need to eat. I need to pay my bills. I need to do everything that everybody else does. But I just don't get so consumed with it that it makes me a monster. I can't do that. So I think, you know, I have a new album that we're mixing right now. But I have a song on my album called While We Still Can. You know, the first line is, let's settle all our petty differences. You know, we need to do some things while we still can. And it's a socially conscious song. The team that I work with is amazing. And what they did was reawaken Mahogany Soul. And it's kind of like Mahogany Soul.
Okay.
So it's going back to, you know, even though I love the Lord, I'm going to be the first one to let y'all know I had to go put my big girl britches back on, and I had to just say, okay, God, give me 5 minutes. Let me get with them on their level. So I had to go there. You know what I mean? Some things I curse in, some things I don't, but I have those days where, you know, I'm always loving the Lord, but I have those days that sometimes the devil just push me too far and I go head up like this.
That's right.
You know, but at the end of the day, the message is still there. And I think you guys are going to love it. My vision and my dream is to see the amphitheater come to life in ways that, you know what, we can make such a statement that the following month or so, you can have a, you know, this, put this on the map. It needs to be put on the map. You know, we were trying to get Music Soul Child and quite a few other artists that were already booked for the day.
Okay.
But guess what? I promise you, the people that are on the show are meant to be on the show. And y'all gonna have a good time because we're gonna go back down memory lane.
Yes.
But we're gonna keep it real gangster. At the end of the day, okay?
At the end of the day. So make sure you get your tickets and listen to K92.7 for your chance to win. August 12th, it is the Summerfest 2017 with Angie Stone, Kenny Lavimore, Raheem Devine, Calvin Richardson, and Sherelle. Now, when we talk about messages in the song, and I was recently talking to Chili of TLC, and she was talking about their new song, Haters, and saying they were talking about bullying and things like that. And the one thing that I like about TLC, and I told her that, is that I feel like all of their songs had some type of message in it back in the day, whether it was same sex, whether, you know, all of that.
Right.
So how do we get back to that? How do we get the artists to get back to giving some type of message in their music?
Well, it begins with the people in control of the dial.
Right.
I mean, we can grind from the bottom up, but it begins with position of power.
Yes.
See, when you are controlled, a lot of stations are conformed to what the hierarchy says you can and cannot.
Right.
My thing is, you have to do more remote live streaming. Why? Because we can do live concerts. Yeah. You know, something that we never do with radio anymore is show something live. Mm-hmm. And therefore, people in the audience can engage, because a lot of people don't even know that I had an album out called Dream. You know, and in order for us to bring awareness, we have to, you know how you can speak without speaking?
Yes.
Sometimes we got, eye contact got to be the source of information. We doing a concert, you can't tell me what they're saying.
Right.
So when I get up there, if all you're doing is streaming, we've got to come up with another approach to get people back into the trenches of great music. It's sad that we got to keep going back to Marvin Gaye, what's going on.
Okay.
We can't get past Marvin Gaye, what's going on. You know, and then we got to go all the way back to the Isley Brothers to get a good love song.
That's great.
You know, you got some that are touching, but I got a song on my album, my new album, where I went there, called Grits.
Grits.
Yes.
Yes. Oh, song is called Grits. And you know,
I'm saying hot grits.
The only reason I say that, I'm gonna go one above your head. The one thing that I say, because I gotta reach the millennials and keep my folks like my age intrigued. The one of the lines is, you call it smashing, but what about passion? You feel me? So it's one of the things that we've allowed our people to change the lingo. So we don't understand nothing what they're saying. So when we don't understand what they're saying, what we tune out. When we tune out, that's a whole generation that tunes out. And that's just the way that the system is designed, but not as long as Sister Girl here. I'm on.
You got it. Right. You can go there. The new album is coming. You got a release date or anything?
Well, we're just mixing. I know it'll be out before the end of September.
End of September. Be on the lookout for Andy Stone's brand new album. And make sure you come out August 12th to the Phoenix City Amphitheater. This lady right here, Sherelle Raheem Devine, Calvin Richardson, and Kenny Lattimore. Gonna go out to you all for just a second. Anybody got a question for Angie? Raise your hand if you got a question.
I know y'all put their phones down for 5 seconds.
I have a question.
Yes.
Being an artist, how do you deal with, because I saw some of the difficulties with your daughter not being home because you're on the road. And I have one son, he just graduated.
Then you know.
And so I'm finding out. So how do you deal with it when they say it's okay and then they come back and they're very angry?
Let me tell you something that I've learned. Life happens. And when God deals us a card that said, this is your journey. You don't know what's on your journey until you walk that journey. Everything that I went through, I was supposed to go through. Because life just happened for me that way. I'm an only child. God said, okay, Angie, when he plucked me from the tree and put me here, I didn't have a clue who I was or what I was going to do. So when I made some choices in life, very young, I had to deal with the consequences that came along with it. My daughter and I are in a great place, amen, by the way, because guess what?
Amen.
She longs to be like me, and she has not one, but two children.
Okay.
And ask me where her baby is right now.
With you.
So I'm just saying this because she came to me and said, Mommy, I'm sorry. Because she understands more than ever what it's like to be pursuing of a dream.
Mm-hmm.
I was already on my journey when I conceived my daughter. So there was no room to turn back. I was a senior, just leaving high school, evaded college because my career took off. So I didn't have the time to go back and fix it, but I'm still here. And that was in 1979. Here we are in 2017. So God has equipped me with all the necessary things I need right now to not just fix my daughter, but fix a generation of daughters.
Yeah.
So that's the walk. Right.
Go ahead.
That's great.
Right.
Do you have I'm recording for a reason. I'm a mentor of some young girls out of middle school who are trying to instill in life things, life lessons, and teaching them how to cook again and sew and balance checkbooks and things. And it's various girls coming from various ages and backgrounds. If you could give my young girls one message that I can share this video or share with them, what would it be?
If I had to snatch another lyric, my advice would be, when you pose for the picture, smile. Don't be in a rush. Sit and stay a while. Mm-hmm. And the reason I say that is because we are often, as young teenagers, we're anxious to get to a place that we've got time to get to. And the one thing we can't do is we can't reverse time. What we can do is waste time. And we can rush time. So my advice would be, just be patient. Sit. Wait a while. Because guess what? I had this very conversation with my 20-year-old son, who was an aspiring artist, who's doing very well, I might add. But because of his anxiety to get to this place called fame, he has decided to trump some things, like going to college for one semester and figuring, like, you know what, I'm gonna be a star. I can wait on that, Mom. I don't wanna go to school. And I'm saying, but we must go to school.
That's right.
Education is key. Right. Well, I'll go back when I. So I said, you know what, you're rushing life. I said, but you're rushing it to get out of high school. I said, unless you go to school right away, you're gonna find yourself sitting around with time on your hands. You're gonna become bored. You're gonna wish that you were back in school. You're not gonna wanna find a job because that wasn't a part of your plan. So I say that to say, I made one mistake with my daughter, but this time I'm gonna get out of the way because you know what? A hard head will make a soft behind every time.
Yes.
So I got out of the way. And every day is, Mom, Mom, no, you sit over there.
That's right.
In that room.
That's right.
Because I want you to see that the friends are not going to come rescue you in that hour.
That's right.
All the ones that's filling your head up with foolishness, they're going about their business. They're not coming. Their parents not going to let them come and help you. So when your car breaks down, and his did, now you can't drive. No, you can't use my car. So guess what? 1 week went by, no friends. 2 weeks, no friends. 3 weeks, Mama, can you run me up? No, I got something to do. So now you're sitting around on your phone on Snapchat because of the choices you made. I got a conversation set up one day. Mama, I think I'm going to get ready to go and roll back in school now. And while you work on my career, that sounds like a plan. But sometimes all it takes is patience. So my advice would be, please don't rush. Savor every minute of the 11th grade, because after the 12th, it's a wrap.
That's right.
You gotta be ready to walk into something bigger than what you just left. And trust me, it's a lot harder now to get into college.
It sure is.
Than it was years ago.
All right. You mentioned something earlier about having to stick to your guns as far as the kind of music that you do. Mm-hmm. What would you say to artists, because we come across a lot of very good music that doesn't necessarily get the airplay. What do you say to those types of artists, those real R&B artists that are kind of stuck with, okay, should I go and do this trap record, or should I just stay and do what I'm with?
Well, one thing I would never do is compromise who I am and what I stand for to fit in to what is going to be a quick fad or something that will change. I'd like to be the game changer and not a part of what has changed me. The reason I say that is because you have to look at trap. Trap is derived where they hang out at from the strip club. So if they've taken the strip club out of the strip club and brought it into the mainstream of things, where then has our mind gone?
Absolutely.
So you have to look at your gift. You have to really, really focus on your gift. You know, there's so many times I say, you know, I want to make a gospel record. But then when I sit back and think about it, my ministry is gospel already. Am I trying to please the people in the church? Or am I trying to reach the people that won't go to church? Because I can always sing a gospel song on that live stage of Real Men. But at the end of the day, I had to learn this the hard way. I was with the group Vertical Hole. I had a different swag. I was younger. So my perception was, what's happening now? I'm trying to get on radio. I'm trying to be, now I'm just doing great music. Music that speaks my situation, that speaks where I am today, that speaks your heart. You know, I wrote a song with a young lady years ago called Why Is It? And the lyrics were, why is it now that I'm in love and found someone, you want me the way I used to want you?
And that was gospel song.
You know, but it took those lyrics for people to go, oh, because it's in there. We just can't process it. And the sad part about that song is, I was spiritually removed from my own feelings. And I was into my man's feelings. And these were his feelings. He never spoke them to me. But I knew that once he linked up with Angie Stone, that all the exes would come out of the woodwork. And I could tell he was troubled by something. So I wrote the song, and the song was basically for me testing, am I right? So in other words, why is it now that I'm in love and found someone, you want me the way you know I used to want you? It's too late because we're through. Why is it someone else had to love me for you to see? This is the song. From somebody, you can kind of take their word on it. Because I'm going in.
All right. We are looking forward to that brand new album end of September. We're going to take a few more questions. Anybody else have any questions?
Go ahead.
Hi, Angie.
Hi.
Now that we live in a day of social media and keyboard courage and people who just thrive off of sensationalism, a lot of times we don't get to know the talent the way that we really want to. So is there anything that constitutes you that has not been put out there that you just want your fans to know about being Angie Stone?
Well, being Angie Stone, I'm glad you asked that question, because I'm not good with social media, because after 50, you got to wear reading glasses pretty much.
Yeah.
40, some people, you know, I'm not as savvy as I would like to be, because number one, I'm not of the computer age group. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm not in school, haven't been in school for quite some time. So my kids are really, really good with this. Mm-hmm. But if there's anything I would like for people to know about me, I have to say it because God is on me to say it. Mm-hmm. You know, when you love the Lord and you love the Lord out loud, like I do, I have a big mouth, I don't care. Mm-hmm. Because at the end of the day, I'm here to please him. Is my duty to my people, all my sisters and brothers, to reel them back into Christ. One thing that I want people to know about me is that everything negative that you hear is not true.
Exactly.
A lot of the pitfalls that the enemy places walls up, from witchcraft to you name it. Mm-hmm. There's so much has been thrown in the water. I can, a lot of times I can't get the shows that I used to get because a lot of promoters in their warped way of thinking have been mm-hmm. conditioned to think I'm difficult. I'm anything but. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm real, but I'm not difficult. Mm-hmm. I'm probably the one artist that has been dumbed down because of my belief in the Creator. So I would say that 9 times out of 10, you know, the Bible tells us that the road to destruction is wide, mm-hmm. the road to salvation is narrow. Very. I'm on the narrow road. So guess what? If you can make it to an Angie Stone concert, there's a blessing in the concert. Yes, it is. There's a blessing in my journey and my purpose. And even though I'm fighting a legion of demons, so to speak, because I love the Lord, I don't fear them.
And kind of continuing a little bit of her question about social media, do you think that social media, I want to say good or bad, because we see the good in it and how artists can put their own music out, they can promote themselves, and you get a better understanding of the artist sometimes. But then on the flip side, you have artists going off, they beefing with this person, and so you see all of it online, and it kind of takes away. I always tell people, one of my favorite artists is Sade, because I don't know a thing about her but her music.
Let me tell you something about social media. And being painfully honest, it has its perks and but if I had to be honest with you, we should have been done away with a long time ago. Mm-hmm. And I will tell you why. It's good that we have a voice, that we can be heard. It's great when, you know, people are trying to put their own music out. But we must remember, in the Bible, it teaches us that music is the highest form of praise. Mm-hmm. And we have to be mindful with that in itself. Mm-hmm. So, I understand with regard to, you know, having program directors and whatnot, the sensationalism of social media is, unless we are following the right stuff, we are being entertained with the wrong stuff. Yes. And a lot of what we zoom into, like who and why do we get off on fights? Who and why can really get behind police brutality? Mm-hmm. And we've become so sensationalized with it that now we expect police brutality. Yeah. We're numb to it almost. Mm-hmm. So we see it. One day it's the talk of the town, the next day it's next. Yeah. And that is a curse to us because we're being mentally
conditioned,
brainwashed.
Right, and you have people that are doing things for how many likes they can get or how many views they can get. That's the world that we live in. There's a picture that I feel like this shows exactly the world we live in. It was saying 20 years ago, somebody was falling off a cliff, everyone's reaching down to help them. Now, everyone pulls out their phone to record them falling off the cliff. Mm-hmm. And that's what we live in. No one is helping you. They want to just, how many likes can I get? It's going straight to the gram. It's going straight to Facebook.
It's sad.
So it is. It's like,
it's scary. It's scary. It's unfortunate. But it's a design and a trick of the enemy to keep you looking away from what is real. It's a distraction. And as a result, we've lost a lot of our musical foundation, our culture. People are just out here now. A lot of the artists that were making great music don't even have a platform anymore. They, you know, you look at the awards, you very rarely see one of, you know, I want to tour with Jeffrey Osborne. I really love him, by the way, his music. Because when I think about LTD, when I think about the music that we grew up on, those people are still out there working. Mm-hmm. But guess what? If you had to book him, Will Downing, T.I., Chance the Rapper, Angie Stone, D'Angelo, I'm just giving you a few nuggets. T.I. would win out.
Yes, yes.
And I ain't saying that's bad because I love him. But at the end of the day, we're going to be entertained by Jeffrey Osborne because he comes from the school of hard knocks. Yeah. And the appreciation factor is greater. Mm-hmm. You're going to be entertained by D'Angelo because he really takes pride in his music. You're going to be entertained by Angie Stone because I realize we have a nation to save. So my whole purpose to do this is a lot more different than the dollar value. Because if I could get a dollar in the weight of my spirit, I wouldn't be able to walk.
Have mercy.
So that's why they could never pay me enough for the gift God gave me. So now, I told somebody last week, we have to now do music again just because we love doing it.
That's right.
And that's where I am.
Passion.
Coffee with Angie Stone. Again, she's in town August 12th. Please get your tickets. Angie Stone, Raheem Divine. Can you? No, because I really want them to come out and enjoy
they need
a great
to come
show.
Out. They
a
need
great
to come
show.
Out. There's a surprise we got.
Okay.
We're going to have some fun. I think people need to come because this is the first time of many that we're trying to make happen.
That's all right. Is Columbus the city you're going to kick it off in?
We're kicking it off here.
Okay.
We are kicking it off here, and I'll tell you something. We're expecting people from Atlanta. We're expecting people from everywhere because I'm going to challenge everybody that can hear this. I'm going to challenge all of you in the room. Pick somebody. Bring them to the concert. Do yourself just say, you know what? If I got one deed to do, I'm going to do it today. And I'm going to follow that up with this. I'll make it real quick. I was in the line at Chick-fil-A about 2 weeks ago. You know, they got two lines. So I shot around this way in a van bigger than my car, try to cut me off. Like, you ain't getting in front of me. Mm. And I looked at this person. I'm like, oh, honey, go ahead. It's not that serious. But they was whoop, 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 whoop. So they shot up to the window, and they got their food. And I just said, thank God for grace and mercy.
Yes.
And when I rolled up to the window, guess what? The girl said, hey, you're the 10th car today. You get all your food for free.